How it's made. Magnets. Magnets are super fun to play with, and we've even grown up with them. However, if you ask anyone about how it's made, it is so rare that you'd get an explanation. Well, our channel exists to give you all sorts of information like this, so welcome back and let's dive right into it. What are magnets? Magnets are any material that creates a magnetic field around it until a certain radius. This field is completely invisible, but you can see it if you get a magnet near scattered iron filings, or you can feel the force experienced by other magnetic materials that attract or repel the magnets. The applications of this are super vast, as you can use it in machinery, electronics, day-to-day utilities, and so on. But before we move into the best section of the video, if you are a first-time viewer of the channel, make sure you smash that subscribe button and also the notification bell. Types of magnets. Before we know how it's made, we have to talk about the types of magnets that exist in our world. There are three major types: natural ones, man-made ones, and electromagnets. The naturally occurring one is called magnetite and has a weak electric field. Man-made ones are the ones that we will be talking about in the video. Electromagnets are extremely versatile and convenient in electrical applications. In man-made magnets, there are two major types: permanent and temporary magnets. Permanent magnets are objects that can be magnetized and would continue to exert a strong and persistent magnetic field. The other types of magnets are made from materials like iron, nickel, and cobalt and their alloys, some alloys of rare earth metals, and some naturally occurring minerals like the lodestone. These are often termed ferro or ferrimagnetic substances. These are further divided into two: soft ferromagnetic materials and hard ferromagnetic materials. Permanent magnets are made from powerful and hard ferromagnetic materials like alnico and ferrite. These are made to undergo special processing techniques in a strong magnetic field during their manufacture to make sure their microcrystalline internal structure is aligned properly, thus making them very hard to demagnetize. To demagnetize a saturated magnet, a certain amount of magnetic field has to be applied. Hard materials have increased coercivity and soft materials have low coercivity. The overall strength of a magnet could be measured by the total magnetic flux it produces. The localized strength of magnetism in a material could be measured by its magnetization. This was the physics aspect of the magnetic materials. Now, let's see how magnets are made. Step 1. Molding of the magnets. There are classic main shapes of magnets that are manufactured in the industry. These molds are filled with sand and smoothened out completely. Then gases are pumped into the furnace and this chemically alters the sand, making it harder. This would next be infused with metals like copper, cobalt, sulfur, pure iron, aluminium, and even titanium. These metals are loaded into an induction furnace and are heated up to 3000 degrees Fahrenheit. This mixes with the sand in the mold and forms the metal mix. It is then cooled. The molds are shattered by the workers or the machines and we obtain a lot of metal pieces. Step 2. Magnetizing the metal pieces. There would be a set of rings, which is a really powerful electromagnet. The ring-covered pipe is placed in a tube with the silica sand hardened metal pieces and both ends of the tube are sealed with concrete. It is then passed through an electric furnace which heats up the tube until it is red. This allows the rings inside to accept an electromagnetic field which will be delivered by this metal rod. The rod slides down the center of the copper pipe and is clamped into place thoroughly. The water keeps the pipe from melting as a low voltage, high current charge is delivered to the rings. Later, the seal is broken and the rings will be mildly magnetized. You may wonder why this isn't very powerful, but it is only because the material is getting prepped for magnetization. This step empowers them with a strong electromagnetic charge, such that the establishment of that weak magnetic field earlier ensures that the magnetization is now properly oriented. This is the basic overview, but how are the next few steps done in an industrial process? Making magnets in the industry. There are various processes to make magnets, but the most common method has to be powder metallurgy, where a pre-decided metal mix is pulverized and heated to melt it all together in a liquid phase sintering. Most of the magnets you find are sintered magnets. Ferrite, samarium cobalt, and neodymium iron boron magnets are all made like this. The Simcoe and neon magnets mentioned before are made first by melting them under a vacuum or some inert gas in an induction melting furnace. This is poured into a mold or processed in a strip caster which forms thin strips. This is then pulverized to form a fine powder that can be from 3 up to 7 microns in diameter. This powder is highly chemically reactive and even capable of igniting spontaneously in the air, and thus must be protected from oxidization in the air. The compacting of this powder is super important as aligning the particles so that in the finished piece all the magnetic regions should be pointing in the prescribed direction. Step 3. Compacting or pressing. This is done by axial or transverse pressing, where the powder is placed in a cavity and just before the pressing the magnetic field is applied. So the compaction just fixes the particles in this alignment. This leads to a high energy product that is very efficient. There is even another compaction method called isostatic pressing, where a flexible container is filled with powder and dunked into a fluid which could be hydraulic fluid or water, which is used to compact it. The main advantages are that large blocks can be made where the powder stays in good alignment. Step 4. Sintering. These are next directed through a vacuum sintering furnace, where the particular temperatures and type of vacuum or inert gas would determine the type and grade of the magnet being produced. This has a well-studied list, and following these conditions are very important. When it reaches room temperature, both materials are given a lower temperature heat treatment. During sintering, the magnetics actually reduce in size to about 15 to 20% of their original size. The finished magnets have a rough surface and irregular dimensions. Step 5. Finishing. The finishing aspect gives shape to the magnets. This requires little diamond wheels for slicing or abrasive wheels for shaping. The magnet material is both brittle yet very hard. Slicing has to be performed with superb precision, and it has to be monitored carefully to prevent cracks and slips. When many pieces have to be manufactured in bulk, about 5,000 or more, tooling is preferred. When pressing to shape, all the material scrap would be minimized, thus avoiding wastage. The order quantity, part shape, size, and complexity will all contribute to the decision of method of manufacture. The delivery time will also affect all the decisions, as making limited quantities from stock blocks is better than ordering tooling for press-to-shape parts. Many specialized magnet shapes can be made from these alloys, but the material we've discussed above are best suited for simpler shapes. Machined magnets will have sharp edges that could be prone to chipping. Making a coat around a sharp edge is also quite problematic. Hence, vibratory honing, which is honing the edges using vibrations, must be done. The dimensions can be specified too, such that one can customize the magnet however you like it. Coating to prevent corrosion or oxidization is the last step, where magnets like neomagnets or Simcoe are coated. The most common protective coatings are dry sprayed epoxy, electrolytic nickel coatings, aluminium, or just a combination of these coatings. Magnets can also be protected with many conversion coatings like zinc, iron, or manganese phosphates and chromates. These are temporary protections, but go a long way to protect the magnets that you use in day-to-day life. Step 6. Charging of the magnets. Once the pieces are obtained, the magnets require charging to produce their own external magnetic field. This can be gotten by using a solenoid or with fixtures that can donate any unique magnetic pattern. Many industries tend to magnetize large assemblies to avoid handling and making these powerful magnets in the magnetized condition. Step 7. Magnetic stabilization and calibration. For good standard magnets, careful stabilization and calibration are extremely important. Stabilization is a way of pre-treating the magnet so that continuous use will not result in the lessening of the magnetic power. On the other hand, calibration is performed to improve the performance of the magnets. How this is done is by treating the magnets in an oven at very high temperatures. These two mentioned properties are extremely important and should be carefully controlled. So, that was it guys, that's how magnets are made. You would find many magnets that often lose their power over time, and these would be cheaper. If you want a really strong magnet, you'd see that it would also cost a lot. This is because of the grueling manufacturing processes that it has to be subjected to. Do you know anything more about how magnets are made? Do you have one at home that you use a lot? And do you know more about its applications? Let us know in the comments below. While you are at it, don't forget to drop the video a like and remember to subscribe to How It's Made. Also, hit that bell icon to turn on post notifications. Subscribe to our channel for more amazing content. Stay safe, science fanatics, and we will see you real soon.